The scope of the prayer meeting is very, very narrow. We just want to lift up the pastor who's preaching. We want to lift up the worship team because they're going to take us into the courts of heaven. And we want to cry out for the lost. That's really what we're praying about. So I'd like to encourage you, it doesn't matter if you come late, if you're only there for 5 minutes, whatever, just come in and join us. We want to experience the presence of the Lord, and we want to see God do great things in our church this year. So if you'll join us building that foundation in prayer, I'm sure that we're going to see amazing things. Please come and join us. Early, late, doesn't matter. Come in for 2 minutes and just lift up our requests to the Lord. And let's see a massive change in the barn this year. In Jesus' name. Church, I'd like to invite you to our pre-service prayer meetings from 7 to 8 on a Sunday morning and from 4 to 5 on a Sunday evening. Everything we do as a church this year, we want success, we want to grow, we want to reach the lost, we want to make a difference for Jesus. It's going to start with the foundation of prayer, so I really want to encourage everybody to come and join us before the services and get into a spirit of prayer. We're going to lift up the worship team, we're going to lift up the preaching, and we're going to cry out for the lost. It's very, very simple. We're not praying for a million different things. And I want to encourage you, if you feel like your faith is weak, come and pray anyway. Jesus commanded us to pray, He commanded us to be persistent, and He commanded us to reach the lost. And that's really what we do. If you pitch up late, just come in, give thanks to the Lord, praise His name, start calling out. Say, Lord, help us, we need your help in this or that endeavor. The scope of the prayer meeting is very, very narrow. We just want to lift up the pastor who's preaching. We want to lift up the worship team because they're going to take us into the courts of heaven. And we want to cry out for the lost. That's really what we're praying about. So I'd like to encourage you, it doesn't matter if you come late, if you're only there for 5 minutes, whatever, just come in and join us. We want to experience the presence of the Lord, and we want to see God do great things in our church this year. So if you'll join us building that foundation in prayer, I'm sure that we're going to see amazing things. Please come and join us. Early, late, it doesn't matter. Come in for 2 minutes and just lift up our requests to the Lord, and let's see a massive change in the barn this year. In Jesus' name. Church, I'd like to invite you to our pre-service prayer meetings from 7 to 8 on a Sunday morning, and from 4 to 5 on a Sunday evening. Everything we do as a church this year, we want success, we want to grow, we want to reach the lost, and we want to make a difference for Jesus. It's going to start with the foundation of prayer. So I really want to encourage everybody to come and join us before the services and get into a spirit of prayer. We're going to lift up the worship team, we're going to lift up the preaching, and we're going to cry out for the lost. It's very, very simple. We're not praying for a million different things. And I want to encourage you, if you feel like your faith is weak, come and pray anyway. Jesus commanded us to pray, He commanded us to be persistent, and He commanded us to reach the lost. And that's really what we do. If you pitch up late, just come in, give thanks to the Lord, praise His name, start calling out. Say, Lord, help us, we need your help in this or that endeavor. The scope of the prayer meeting is very, very narrow. We just want to lift up the pastor who's preaching. We want to lift up the worship team because they're going to take us into the courts of heaven. And we want to cry out for the lost. That's really what we're praying about. So I'd like to encourage you, doesn't matter if you come late, if you're only there for 5 minutes, whatever, just come in and join us. We want to experience the presence of the Lord, and we want to see God do great things in our church this year. So if you'll join us building that foundation in prayer, I'm sure that we're going to see amazing things. Please come and join us. Early, late, it doesn't matter. Come in for 2 minutes and just lift up our requests to the Lord. And let's see a massive change in the barn this year. In Jesus' name.
Testing 1, 2. Good morning, everybody. There's a car that is number plate is FL54SPGP. You're going to turn in circles for the next hour. Your flicker light is on. So we just want to help you. If it's your car, please go and deliver it.
Good morning, everybody. Welcome to the barn. Amen. Let's all stand as we worship and praise God this morning. And during the week, I was watching this video, and there was this worship leader. I think his name was Jaron Davis. He's been around for a while, and he said something which I thought, wow. You know, I never thought of this the way worship this way. And he says, you know, sometimes people come into church and they say, I'm coming for the word. That's it. I'm coming for the word. And he says, you know what? He says, when you come to receive the word, you're receiving from God. You're receiving the word. But he says, why don't we as believers come in with an attitude of praise and worship? Because when you praise, you give to Him. You give your worship. You give your praise. Amen. So I want to encourage you this morning. Let's praise Him, let's worship Him, and give to Him. We're going to receive the word which Rudolph has received from God, and He will preach it to us, and we receive it. Whether it chastises us, whether it encourages us, we receive what God is saying through His word. So I want to encourage you today. Let's not just be here to receive, let's give today as well. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Father, we thank you for a time like this. Lord, a time where we can gather together as one with the saints and other believers today to worship and praise you, to receive what you want to say to us today. And Lord, we just pray, Lord, that you would just, Lord, dwell amongst us. Do what you want to do, Lord. Even as we praise you, as we worship you, Lord, as you say in your word, our worship is like a savor in your nostrils today. And we pray, Lord, that our worship would be that today to you, Father. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
I'm sure praise when I'm doubting. I praise when outnumbered, praise when surrounded. His praise is the waters my enemies drowning. Say, as long as I'm breathing, I've got a reason to praise. lot of praise the Lord, oh my soul. I praise when I feel it, I praise when I don't. I praise 'cause I know you're still in control. My praise is a weapon, it's more than a sound. Praise is the shout, yeah, that brings Jericho down. Say, as long as I'm breathing, I've got a reason to praise the Lord, oh my soul. My God is alive. How could I keep it inside? Come on and praise the Lord, oh my soul. I've got to praise. Let's worship Him. I praise 'cause you're sovereign, praise 'cause you reign, praise 'cause you rose and defeated the grave. Praise 'cause you're faithful, praise 'cause you're true, praise 'cause there's nobody greater than you. I praise, praise 'cause you're sovereign, praise 'cause you reign, praise 'cause you rose and defeated the grave. Praise 'cause you're faithful, praise 'cause you're true, praise 'cause there's nobody greater than you. Praise the Lord, oh my soul. Come on and praise the Lord, oh my soul. Oh, I will praise the Lord, oh my soul. Come on, let's praise the Lord, oh my soul. I won't be quiet, my God is alive. How could I keep it inside? I won't. My God is alive. How could I keep it inside? Oh, I won't be quiet, my God is alive. How could I keep it inside? Lift your voice and praise the Lord, oh my soul. Come on and praise the Lord, oh my soul. One more time, say praise the Lord, oh my soul. Praise Him. Hallelujah. It's worthy.
Thank you, Lord.
Praise you, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord.
I was lost in shame, could not get past my blame until He called my name. I'm so glad He changed me, darkness held me down, but Jesus pulled me out and I'm no longer bound. I'm so glad He changed me, see I now a new creation in Christ. The old has gone, there's new life. I live by faith, not by sight. There is a new name written down in glory, and it's mine, yes, it's mine. Sin had left me blind, but Jesus opened my eyes. Now I see the light. I'm so glad He changed me. Now I'm walking free. I've got the victory. See, it's all over me. I'm so glad he changed me. See,
I'm a new creation in Christ.
The old is gone.
I met the author of my story, and he's mine. Yes, he's mine.
There is a new
name,
yeah,
down in glory, and it's mine. Yes, it's mine.
Oh, hallelujah.
I met the author of my story, and he's mine. Yes, he's mine.
Say, show me.
I am because the I am tells me who I am. I am who I am because the I am tells me who I am.
Say,
I am who I am because the I am tells me who I am. I am who I am because the I am tells me who I am.
Say,
I am who I am because the I am tells me who I am.
Down in glory, and it's mine.
Yes, it's mine.
Say,
I met the author of my story, and it's mine. Yes, it's mine.
There is a new
name,
yeah.
Down in glory, and it's mine. Yes, it's mine.
Oh, hallelujah.
I'd like to read this passage of scripture. It just relates to the two songs that we're going to do next. And it says in Revelation 4 verse 8, and the four living creatures, each one of them having six wings, are full of eyes around and within, and day and night they do not cease to say, holy, holy, holy is the Lord the Almighty, who was and who is and who is to come. And when the living creatures give glory and honor and thanks to him who sits on the throne and to him who lives forever and ever, the 24 elders will fall down before him who sits on the throne and will worship him who lives forever and ever, and will cast their crowns before the throne, saying, worthy are you, our Lord and our God, to receive glory and honor and power, for you created all things, and because of you will they exist and be and were created. Amen. And even as I've read the scripture today, the Bible speaks about the angels singing day and night, holy, 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 worthy, worthy, worthy are you, Lord. And today, let's sing it. Let's sing holy to him. Let's tell him he's worthy. Amen. Because he inhabits our praises. Amen.
Thank you.
the Lamb of God and sing,
you're worthy of it all.
You're worthy of it all.
generations, falling down in worship to sing the song of ages to the land. And all who've gone before us, and all who will believe, will sing the song of ages to the land. Your name is the highest, your name is the greatest, your name stands above them all thrones and dominions, all powers and positions, your name stands above them all, and the angels cry. Dominions, all powers and possessions, your name, it stands above them all. Jesus, your name is the highest, your name is the greatest, your name, it stands above them all. All thrones and dominions, all powers and positions, your name, it stands above them all, and the angels cry, holy, all creation cries, holy, you are lifted high. Say, holy to the King of Kings, holy, you will always be, holy, holy forever, you will always be. We
cry holy to you, Jesus. We cry holy, God, to you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Yeah. Holy are you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Holy, holy. Holy forever, God. Yeah. Thank you, Jesus. And the angels cry,
holy.
All creation cries,
holy.
You are lifted high,
holy.
Holy forever. Hear you people sing. Sing this morning, holy.
Holy.
To the King of Kings.
Holy.
You will always be.
Holy. Holy forever.
Oh God, yeah. You will always be. You will always be holy, holy forever. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, God. We can worship a holy God. Thank you, Jesus. We give you all the glory. We worship you, our Lord. You are worthy to be praised. Let's sing it this morning. We give you all. We give you all the glory. We worship you, our Lord. You are worthy to. Jesus, we give you all the glory. We worship you, our Lord. You are worthy to be praised. You're worthy, God. To be praised, Lord, yeah. We give you praise, Lord. We worship you this morning, God. You're worthy. You're worthy, Lord. You're worthy, Jesus. We give you everything this morning. We glorify. Yeah, yeah. Oh, praise belongs to you. Oh, praise belongs to you, Jesus. Oh, worship belongs to you, Jesus. You are amazing, God. We give you all the glory, oh Jesus. We worship you, our Lord. You are worthy to be praised. Just the choir sing it. Amen. We give you all the glory. We worship you. We worship you, our Lord. Thank you, God.
You are worthy to be praised.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, God. Thank you, Lord. You're worthy to be praised, Almighty God. You're worthy to be praised, Lord. We worship you. We worship you, Lord, amazing God. Shall ever see and hear, my almighty God, we worship you. Glory unto you, O God.
This morning, maybe it's the colder weather. Come on, let's raise our hands to the Lord when we sing this song. We give you our worship. We give you our worship. I shouldn't invite you to do that. We should just do it this morning. So can we do it? It's a biblical thing to raise our hands to the Lord. Sean, can we sing it again?
Sure.
And I just wanted to be a bit more free this morning.
Yeah.
You know, I pray every day. I say, thank you, Lord, that we have a free country where we can worship. But then I say, Lord, but some of us are not free to worship yet. We're still in our religion. We're still bound by just coming here and sitting and watching a show and not participating. And that's what I pray for you today and me today as well. And we're coming up to Pentecost in a few weeks' time. That your freedom of worship would become free. Free in the spirit. And experiencing God a lot more than what you are. So would you do that with me this morning? I speak to myself as well. Lord, we give you all our worship. We give it to you. And this is a sign. Lord, I give it to you. I raise my hands. I give it to you. It's also a sign of surrender. But it's definitely a sign of worship. I give you all the glory today. I give you all the glory today, Lord. Thank you, Lord God, that you're not dependent on weather, on cold or hot. You're not dependent on my circumstances. Who you are is who you are. Whether I'm down in the dumps or up on a mountaintop, whether I go through difficult times or whether I am excited about life, you never change. You are there to be worshipped and there to be glorified.
Yes,
and we repent,
God.
Lord, of spectatorship this morning.
Yes,
and I
God.
Pray that you would set us free in our spirits this morning
yes,
to
God.
Worship you in spirit and in truth. And if some of us have not been filled with the Holy Spirit yet, I pray, Holy Spirit, fill them now in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus, Lord, we give you all the glory. We give you all the glory, all the praise, and we worship you. Set our tongues on fire, Lord. Warm our hearts towards you, Lord. Change our hearts, Lord. Revive us, oh God. Do a miracle in us, Lord. Lord, we are tired of dryness. Breathe on us. Breathe on us so we would rise up a vast army ready to conquer and ready to reach out for God. Fill this place with your presence, Lord God. Fill this place with your presence, God. We are tired of religious acts, Lord. We want to bow our knee before you in worship this morning, Lord God. Fill us with your spirit, Lord. Will you raise your hands with me and just say, Holy Spirit, fill me this
morning in Jesus' name. Fill me this morning in Jesus' name. Fill me this morning in Jesus' name. Won't you just start singing with Shaunya? Just sing God praises. Make up your own song and just worship Him from your spirit today.
You are worthy, God. You are worthy, Lord. We praise your name. We give you all the glory. We worship you, our Lord, oh God. You are worthy to be praised. We give you all this morning.
Thank you that we don't serve a dead God or a dead religion, but we live in an era of Pentecost where the Spirit was poured out upon us in power. We will receive power because we have the Spirit of God in us and on us.
Yes, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Fill us, Holy Spirit, in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. And all God's people say,
amen.
Amen. Amen. Come on. Won't you turn to the person behind you and say, now you worshiped. Hey? I trust you are all well. God is good. Amen, amen. One of my favorite passages in the Bible, and I've got so many. I think if I shared all the favorite passages in the Bible, I'll stand here all day long for the next 35 years or something. But one is in 1 Chronicles chapter 21. And you can go and read that passage there. And David did something that the Lord instructed him not to do. And the Lord said to him, don't count the army. Go into battle. Don't count the Israelites. Just go and be obedient. And David, the king, thought he was going to be clever. He counted them. And God was so upset with him that you go and read the story, and it was going to be quite disastrous. But anyway, in the end, he goes to a person that's selling a piece of land, a threshing floor. And he wants to take that threshing floor and build an altar to the Lord. An altar to the Lord because he sought God's forgiveness and now he's seeking to worship God. So he decides to build an altar there. And the owner of the land said to him, sir, you are my king. I'm going to give you the land. And he says, no, I will pay for the land. And the guy says to him, I think two or three times, sir, you are the king. I will give you the land. Take the land. And David again says, no, I will not take the land. And then he says this. He says, the king replied, I insist on paying the full price. I will not take for the Lord what is yours or sacrifice a burnt offering that cost me nothing. Very significant passage in the Bible. You know, somebody once said, Any person whose walk with God is not a walk of sacrifice has not come to fully surrender to Him. A fully surrendered life means sacrifice. And we sacrifice with our finances, we sacrifice with our time, we sacrifice to serve, we sacrifice in coming here every Sunday to worship God. A fully surrendered life knows sacrifice. And the opposite is also true. So I just find this passage so interesting. David says, I will not, I insist, I'm paying. I will not sacrifice a burnt offering that is costing me nothing. So that's my question to you today and to myself as well. How much of what I do as a believer is sacrificial? Or am I just in for the ride? And I think that's quite something to meditate on today. So I want to ask the ushers to come and take up the offering. And we've got a few notices that we want to play on the screen. Please listen. This is the life of your church. It is so important because we do this. We hand out the pamphlets. We send it out. We make these videos and still people say, we didn't know that happened in our church. So please take note of these videos.
Just to let you know, in June, July, we've got a couple of outreaches, one going to Malawi and one going to Oudtshoorn. If you want to be part of an outreach, please check the website out and sign up for that. And also, we're going to have a little pamphlet in the foyer today. If you're interested, please pick up one of those pamphlets so that we know who you are and you can find out more details about the outreaches. They are such fun to be part of and we'd love you to join us. The other thing is, on this coming Monday, for 9 weeks, we've got the Effective Parenting course coming up. That's going to be in the Counseling House. And the whole idea is to raise kids for God in a defective world. So if you want to make sure that you're raising your kids upright, following God's principles, please join that course. And also, you're welcome to invite other people, other parents who want to learn how to raise their kids effectively. So that's starting at 7 o'clock on Monday. The Alpha course also starts on Monday night in the auditorium for 9 weeks. And the Alpha course is basically get your questions answered. If you have questions about your Christianity, come along and join us for that. Other than that, the next week is on the 28th of April, we are having our child dedication. If you want to dedicate your kids to the Lord, please go on the website, sign up for that as well, because you will get together and just discuss it with other parents as well. So you've got a lot to look at. Sign up, join the website, look and see what you want to be involved in. Hi ladies, we're so excited to just speak to you a little bit about upcoming things. We would love you to join the Fearless WhatsApp group, which is out in the foyer, the QR code. Please join it, because we should have about 500 ladies on that group, so that we can just communicate with you when we have a ladies meeting coming up. We don't give anything else, just upcoming events. And just so, by the way, next Saturday is our ladies' picnic. We would love you to come along and join us. You're welcome to bring your kids, bring your picnic basket with, and also a scarf to swap with someone, and a book if you'd like to give a book in. We're going to have a bit of a book library. It's just going to be a fun time, a few games, and it's a social. So from 9 o'clock to 11 next Saturday, the address is 64 Lawrence Road, Poortview, which is just behind the Botanical Gardens. So we'd love you to come along and join us. Sign up, let us know that you're coming. Thank you.
Hi, Barn family. I'm Mel.
And I'm Audrey.
As you know, one of our core values at the Barn is to help our immediate community. And we have started a care room. The care room will consist of food and clothing essentials.
Many people think that your little bit of help is not going to help. It is going to help. We're asking you that if you go to the shop and you're busy with your trolley, try adding a few extra items. And the items that we're thinking of is things that are non-perishable, such as pastas, beans, rice, dishwashing liquid, cooking oil, face soap. And if you want more information, you can email Zoe at the Barn, and she can give you the list that we're asking you to get as well.
And if you bring the non-perishables with you to church, 5 or 8 o'clock or 10 o'clock service, you can drop it in the blue box at Panda Pen.
We thank you for your generosity.
Thank you.
Fantastic. Audrey printed these bags. Now, this is not for you to take and do your private shopping. Okay, this is really not. So there's a couple of these bags here. How many have we got? The idea is to fill them up. There's even goodies that you can put in to fill them up and bring them back next week, Sunday, or in the week, so that we can get other people to do the same as well. And that's how we're going to help people that are struggling in our community, in our church as well. So how do you sign up for things? There's a QR code. There's a QR code for everything in this place. You know, so I don't know if we still give out the little pamphlet that we give it out today. But if you go to our website just ask Zoe at the back there, you sign up, ladies meeting coming up, and all those kind of things. We're still looking for volunteers, folks. We have, at the end of last year, and we'll give you the new stats next week, we had 292 volunteers in our church, and we are doubling that this year. So the volunteers that we're really looking for is ushers, and we want to double our ushering team, and we'll train you, we'll help you how to do it as well. If you want to join the ushering team, then please write your name today on that whiteboard. And we will contact you. And then the generational ministries. We had a generational ministry training session here two Fridays ago. And it was amazing to see about 70 people. Now, before COVID, we had almost 200 people that were on that group. It was amazing to see the group and so on. But one of the things that struck us was that almost 90%+ of those who were on the group were teenagers. That means as adults, I'm going to say it, we're neglecting to minister to our children. We're neglecting to minister to our children. We need you. It's not just a woman's thing. Go and play with the children. We teach them the Word of God. We teach them biblical principles. We will train you in doing these things. So please, if you want to help us there, we need at least 30, 40 plus adults. Friday nights and Sunday mornings to help us. It's not a life sentence. It is one of the most amazing ministries in the church. So please sign up today. Then also, if you would like to get involved in our coffee shop, we're looking for volunteers to run it for us. So please get involved and help us there. Father, we thank you that you are a generous God. Thank you that you have taught us through Jesus Christ that this life of Christianity is about serving. And thank you that you've called us, that you will equip us and you will empower us to be great servants in the kingdom of God, great servants in this church as well, and great servants in this community. And we thank you that there's no pedestal for any one of us here, but there's just an apron. And we want to put our aprons on and work for your glory and extend your kingdom in Jesus' name. Amen. I want to chat to you about some biblical interventions throughout history. You know, one thing that I realize is so often you and I as believers do not read our Bible anymore. Carol has got some stats. I think some people open their Bible once in. Over 50% of believers open their Bible only once or maybe twice a month. Open their Bible only once or twice a month. And that's why many of us struggle to understand the Bible stories. We struggle to understand who God is and how God acted and how God, because of how he acted, how he also will potentially act in the future in our lives as well. It's so important because the Bible is our guide. Let me tell you from the beginning, I'm going to give you some stories over the next few weeks and months maybe as of some of the divine interventions, some of the times where God came to humanity in an amazing, powerful way, in fact, in miraculous ways. And in fact, if you don't believe that the Bible is the inspired word of God, it's difficult to believe some of these stories. And that's where we've got to start. We've got to start as believers to say, this is not a guide. This is not a manual. This is the authoritative Word of God. This is how we live, and this is how God acts and has acted. And I'm going to give you reason to rejoice and reason to doubt. But you've got to then, when you doubt, make a decision to say, will I believe this book? Or will I believe what the world is trying to teach me? Right, some of these divine interventions throughout the Bible history. You know that somebody once said that history is actually his story? And when I look at it, it's actually so true. It is God's actions, God's ways of dealing with humanity right through. Now, unfortunately, since the Bible has been written, sometimes we don't see the things that are happening in our world as actions from God. And sometimes when people try and tell us those are actions or interventions of God, we doubt it. All right? So, but what we have written here is clear evidence that God from time to time came and intervened and interacted with mankind. And so it is his story we will be looking at in the Old and the New Testament. And I will explore with you some of those biblical narratives. Genesis chapter 1 is where it all started. I would love you to bring your Bible with and a notebook when we go through these stories together. Genesis chapter 1, my friend, is really a story where the power of God in one of the most amazing, most powerful ways is demonstrated. In the first chapter of the Bible, when you read that first chapter, and I'm going to unpack it a little bit for you today, you see here, you come head on with the power of God. You come so head on with the power of God that many doubt. And I'm gonna tell you just now where some of us doubt the word of God. But we see the enactment, we see the power of God, the demonstration. And for some, Genesis chapter 1, 2, and 3 is a controversial passage. But for those of us who believe in the Bible, it is a wow passage where we say, this is my God. This is how he does it and how he did it. So first of all, right in the beginning, there is an intervention of God. There is a divine visitation of God when God created. When God created. And my Bible starts like this, and it says, in the beginning, Elohim created. God created. In the beginning, God created. And that word beginning is Bereshith in the Hebrew, and it means what it says it means. What it says, it means in the beginning. The only thing that was before the in the beginning was the one who spoke things into being. So that's the most difficult, or one of the most difficult things to understand. And I remember as a teenager when I really wrestled with my issues of faith and where I come from and where God comes from and so on. As I could see myself once sitting, I want to, that's maybe what Nick did, pull my hair out. And I said, God, but where did you come from? Where did you come from? And that is an impossible question to answer. There is no data. There is no story. There is no Google. There is no nothing you can go and saying, okay, this is the origin of God. What we know is that he existed before the origin of everything else. In the beginning, God created. So this verse is packed with meaning. As I said just now, in the beginning. The second one, God's name, we're going to unpack a little bit. And the fact that God created the heavens and the earth. Up to when I left school, things were still quite biblical in our schools. We read Bible stories. We were told that God created the heavens and the earth. And we didn't doubt those. We didn't believe in millions and billions of years. We believed in short, it was done in a short time. And I'm going to come back to that in a moment. We just believed that God existed. And even those that didn't like him, didn't follow him, had sort of an idea. Yeah, no, I do believe in God. Today, our children, if they don't hear it at home, will not hear the gospel at all. And so you've got a great job to tell them about the Lord Jesus Christ. You see, first of all, God is the ultimate being. He exists independently of time and space and matter. Nothing confines him. For this reason, he cannot be identified with this universe. Listen to me. Because some people, so God, the universe is not God, and God is not the universe, like some people are trying to tell us today. He created the universe. He is outside of that. He is holding it together. God is God. He is transcendent. Over and above what he has created. He is not limited by what he has created. He is not at all in our space, in a sense. Everything you see is had a starting point except God. And I know it's a difficult concept. And maybe one day we'll find out how it all happened. But at the moment, all we know is God was and is and will ever be. And then things started to happen. 1 Timothy chapter 1 verse 17, it says this. Now to the King eternal, immortal, invisible, the only God, be honor and glory forever and ever.
Folks, you've got to start with believing. If you are a believer, if you're a Christian, if you're a follower of God, you've got to start with God. You've got to start with the fact that He is ultimately above everything you and I will ever know and has ever known, has ever seen, and will ever see. There is absolutely no one like Him. He's not limited by space or matter, because the Bible says He is omnipresent. It blows your mind to think that the same God that we worship and believe is in our midst here today is at the same time in a church, in a family, in a believer that is 8 hours behind us or 8 hours ahead of us. Sometimes I want to phone my friend in New Zealand. Are they 8 hours behind us or before us? Doesn't really matter. Eh? Behind us, I think. So I said, guys, we've already won the rugby. Are you guys, you're going to see it in 8 hours' time? He says, no, Rolf, it doesn't work like that. I also watched it. I said, okay, as long as you know that. It's just got to do with the sun and where the sun shines and doesn't shine. So God is the ultimate. Second, God is the source of everything that exists. And in Hebrew, the Hebrew word in Genesis chapter 1, verse 1, when it says, and God created, is the word bara. And the word bara means that it was, and in the context of God, and whenever it's used in the context of God, the word bara means something that was created out of nothing. That's the Hebrew word bara. It is only used about God. It is only used about God's creation. You see, you and I cannot create something out of nothing. We're trying very hard through science, but they need something to create something. The word bara speaks about the power of God that has enabled Him to create something. Now, human beings have created some beautiful poetry, music, skyscrapers, and all that stuff. But we use pre-existing material to do it. That's the difference between us and God. We can never create anything out of nothing. Thirdly, when we think of this verse, there's so much out of this verse. Is God created the universe out of ex nihilo? That means out of nothing. He created this universe out of nothing. And the Bible says, and God created the heavens and the earth, Genesis chapter 1, verse 1 and 2. And listen to it. The earth was beautiful, in place, formed and shaped. No. It was without form. It was void. It was chaotic. It was a mess. So He created the heavens and the earth. Pagan religions believe that their gods, that whatever god they worship, is that their gods use pre-existing material to mold and to fashion the world. That's why the God that we serve, the God of the Bible, the God of the Jews, the God of Christians, today we celebrate, and the Bible insists that however God brought anything and everything into existence by the word of His power, by the spoken word, He created everything that you and I see. Another thing that I get out of this verse is that the universe, it seems, was not created in its final form, but God created it over time and period, and you will see as it unfolds in Genesis chapter 1. The earth was without void. Empty. So the earth was there, but it was void. So God then started the process of making it look the way it is today. The shape, He molded it. Something good and something beautiful. How should we respond to the doctrine of creation? Well, there's one or two ways that we should respond. The most important thing that we should do, you and I, when we think of this God of creation, is obviously we should worship the sustainer and the creator of this universe. We should worship him. My dear friends, I don't know how many laws there are in place to govern the universe, to keep it in its form. But one of the things that I often think of, what if God just removes one of that? And that's the law of gravity. Groot gemors. Big bumps. Groot blowkolle. Because immediately, if God stops just for one moment, and science is not as powerful, science is not as clever, it is the creator that holds this stuff in the power of his mighty hand, the Bible says. But if for 1 second, God removes that law that he put into place, what's going to happen? We will bounce off these roofs, and if you haven't got a roof, ek weet nie waar you're going to land nie, because it's going to be in trouble for you. So God sustains these things, created these things, and he is to be worshipped. Acts chapter 17, verse 28 says, "For in him we live and move and have our being." In Job chapter 12, verse 10, it says, "In his hand is life of every creature and the breath of mankind." In his hand, my friend, is life, the life of every creature and the breath of all mankind. I've worked out in my life and I've seen a lot of sick people and I've been ill myself from time to time. Is that medicine cannot do what God alone can do. That's a fact. He is to be worshipped. This means that everyone independent of God or everyone is dependent on God and everyone is accountable to God. And although even the unbeliever is dependent on God for the breath that they breathe, they refuse to be accountable to God and they will give account for that one day. Thank God your eyes have been opened. In Romans chapter 3, verse 19, now we know that whatever the law says, it says to those who are under the law, so that every mouth may be silenced and the whole world be held accountable to God. And there's a day that's going to come where every mouth, every knee, will confess and be bowed before God, but some unwillingly. And some without faith. We owe God everything, my friend. We owe God everything. Without him, we do not exist. And maybe therefore, we need to dispel the lie that we are autonomous, independent, and self-sufficient. We are not. We are not. We respond secondly by, and I want you to get this with me today, and it's just something that I thought about in the week, is we have got to stop believing that everything that God created is evil in this world. And there are believers that are going around, and pagans teach you this, everything is evil, matter is evil. No. God created everything. And what did he say 6 times when he created stuff? Every time he stopped and he says, and it was good. And when he created humans, he stopped and he says, and it was, believe it or not, very good. Look at your husband and say to him, very good. Come on now, men like that. Men like that. And I say it to them, very good. My patient, God made you. Thanks, Carol, for saying that. I can see you mumbling it there. I can see you mumbling it there. When God created man, it was very good. God is good. And his creation is good. It is what we do with it that's not always good. And we are responsible for that as well. And initially, evil did not exist.
It came in a bit later, and I'm not going to have time to discuss it this morning. But God promised. And even though this world has fallen, even though this world is damaged by us, even though this world is not only wrecked by our irresponsible actions of just beating it up day after day, it is also wrecked by our fallen, sinful nature. Because wars and all the stuff you read about is not because God is a God of love. It's because we are sinful people. That's why there are all these evil things in the world today. A proper understanding, friend, of Genesis chapter 1, verse 1, ensures that we give God the glory and honor for creating and sustaining this universe. The proper response to all of this is to present our bodies a living sacrifice. Romans chapter 12, 1 and 1 Corinthians 6, verse 19 to 20. It says we were made by Him and for Him. Let me explain one or two more things that I'm going to close today. I want to just stop quickly to tell you what the significance, the amazing significance of the word Elohim is in the Bible. Because it says, in the beginning, God, Elohim, created. The word El is God. Elohim is the plural God, okay? So that stirs a little bit of excitement in some people, and I'll come to that in a moment. But the word Elohim is used for either gods with a small g or a big G, okay, in the Bible and in other writings. It's one of the most common names of God. Actually, it's not nearly a name of God. It describes God, all right? Jehovah Jireh means God, my provider. But this word, Elohim, describes who He is, and I'll come back now, I've already said it. It describes God, the creator of this universe. The word Elohim is used 2,500 times in the Jewish writings. The basic meaning of the word Elohim is strength and power. So it's not His name. It describes who your God is. When you say Elohim, you say power, strength. And you know what? I just think of creation, and I cannot deny power and strength. Elohim is infinite. Elohim is all powerful. Elohim shows by His works that He is the creator. And anything you take away from Him as the creator, you take away power and strength from God. The word Elohim grammatically is plural rather than singular. And that for some people is a problem, because the singular of the word Elohim is Eloah. So if you now go back, and if you don't remember these things, don't worry too much about it. But if you go back to this word, Elohim, in the Torah, it says there is only one God. So the Jews try and explain it away. Elohim cannot mean more than one God, because we do not believe in more than one God. Even we don't believe in more than one God. That's polytheism. Polytheism. Where there's many gods. No, we don't say there's many gods. But the word Elohim, if you look at the creation story, it even says there, let us. Who's God speaking about? Let us, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, create. Let us. That's the strength of that word from a grammatical point of view. But from the power point of view, as He created, the Bible says, the heavens and the earth. Genesis describes it. Psalms describe us. The prophetic writings describe that. Historical narratives describe the power of God. Elohim is power, sovereignty, transcendence. Folks, we are not dealing with a mate, with the old man upstairs. Please don't ever say that. It's disgusting to talk about God like that. Absolutely disgusting. It dishonors God
and makes him equal to you or me or a father, it's not who he is. The Hebrews would not pronounce his name Yahweh without taking out the, they wouldn't even write his name Yahweh. They would remove the vowels because they could not get themselves to call him Yahweh. We've lost some of that honor and respect for this amazing, great, wonderful God. Let me ask you a question. Two questions, and the one you're not going to like too much, maybe. How did God create? It's simple. And God said. Simple. You see, you've got to believe the Bible to be a believer. And then you don't be selective when you want to be a believer. Say, well, you know, this sounds a little bit, I don't know. It doesn't fit my scientific view of creation. Well, let your scientific view fit in with a biblical view. Because that's what's written here. So I'm telling you what the Bible says, not your science teacher. What the Bible says. And there are many scientists who believe and have strengthened the view of what I'm going to tell you now. First of all, how? By speaking. And God said. How long did it take is the problem. Billions of years? No. This I believe with all my heart. And many scientists have and you can go to websites like Genesis.com and others, and you'll see how simple it is, and I'll explain it to you. If we believe in the Bible, this is what you will believe. According to the narrative in Genesis chapter 1, it took God 6 days to create the universe. 6 days to create the universe. The biblical word for day is yom. Now, it is true that people can say to you, well, Rulof, does day not mean more than just a 24-hour day? Yes, it does. It can mean more than a 24-hour period, okay? So let me give you examples of what a day, yom, may mean to you. If you're saying something like this, oh, in the days of our fathers, or in the day of my father, what does that mean? It refers to an era, a time. So I use the word day, but I describe a time period. What do you mean by when you say the following thing? It says, you know what? The day of the Lord. What would that be? What do you mean when you say this will be the day? You're using the same word, don't you? Okay, so what I'm saying to you is the context of in which you use the word will determine what that word means. Are you happy with it so far? All right. If you're not happy, then you're going to buy me a lot of coffees after the sermon. All right. Because I think we diminish the power of God when we don't believe what this book says. God could have told you, and the first 1,758 years and 820 and 57 commas, like Zuma, I created this. Then I rested a little bit, and then it took me another 2,058 and 59, 75, 600, 545 to create. No, he said it as it is. Believe it. So what is the context of the word yom in Genesis chapter 1? Simple. Listen to it. I'll go to the Bible. He created light and darkness, and there was evening, and there was morning, the first day. What does that mean? What does that mean? Other than what it means. What does it mean? Folks, we diminish the power of God. You know, science need to observe data to give you facts. Where is the data they have observed and stored since the creation 5 billion, 20 billion years ago? Where's the data? Don't be fooled. Believe what the Word of God says. It is simple. It is powerful. It makes Elohim who Elohim is. It fits with dinosaurs, all of that stuff. It's not outside of this time period. That's why it says like this. And then it goes on. And it says, and it was morning, or evening and morning, the third or the second or the fourth. Or the, you know why God did it like this? Because he knew that 2,000 years or 3,000 or 6,000 years later, some scientists would want to disprove the God of creation. That is exactly what Darwin himself says in his own words. I am an Anglican boy. Grew up as an Anglican. What do you call those boys that? Altar boy. Upset with the church, upset with God, and he himself said these words, recorded, I will disprove the God of creation. Your children believe what he says. My children will believe what the Bible says. And I hope you say the same with me today. Why did God say, and it was evening, it was morning, that's the first day. It's like grade one stuff. Now, Brendan, I want you to understand something. When I say day, Brendan, this is what I mean. Evening, morning. So you go to, you know me well enough. Evening, you go to bed, Brendan. When you wake up the next morning, it's morning. So Brendan, that's day one. So that 24-hour cycle is day one. Simple. When I will believe it about everything else, but I won't believe it about God. Elohim. Nick will answer all the other questions you have about this. The context here is that this amazing God, this powerful God, got up one day, if he did lie down, and said, you know what? I am going to be creative. I'm going to create heavens and earths. I'm going to make lights. I'm going to, Christmas is going to, what you guys do at the shops here, just see what I do up there. I'm going to put them into orbits and make sure that they don't crash into the earth, and the sun is going to warm it by day, and the night is going to give light by the moon by night. I'm going to make trees and gardens, and I'm going to make seas, and I'm going to make rivers, and all these beautiful things. And I'm going to make somebody that I'm going to call Adam, man. And I know what's going to happen. I know what's going to happen, God said. Because God knows everything. I'm going to ask God, why did he do that? I thank you that you did, because that's why I'm here. But I want to ask him one day, God, why? Because you know everything. Why did you continue to create? Why didn't you stop short of man? Because you knew what he was going to do. And that's what I'm going to come to next week. You knew what he was going to do. Why did you do that? You see, this little peanut brain doesn't understand all that stuff. But if you think you come from an ape, it's okay with me, but I don't. I really don't. And if we develop from apes, why are they not in between still? Looking at some of us, maybe. Why are there nothing in between then? Why? Scientists are jumping backwards to disprove the God of creation. Go to creation.com and see many reputable Christian scientists telling you what I'm telling you today. God created, and it was morning, evening, and morning, the first day. He did it for six days, and then he rested. And he says, well, why did he rest is the question. I'm not going to answer that today. All right.
I hope these divine interventions are going to help you to understand that you serve an absolutely amazing, powerful Heavenly Father. Elohim. Elohim is your God. Elohim is your God. Bring him into your life today. Bring him into your circumstances today. And if he could speak that into being, surely nothing is too hard for him in your life. Let's pray. Father, we thank you that although we don't have all the answers, we have enough. Enough to believe, enough to rejoice, enough to stand in awe, enough to bow before you in your greatness. Elohim, all-powerful, all-knowing, all-seeing. Our peanut brains wants to seize when we think of your greatness. But God of creation, we bow before you today. We bow. And all we can do is surrender. You're not dependent on us. We are definitely dependent on you. You don't need us, although you love us. We definitely need you, even though we try to love you. Father, I pray that the scales of our eyes will fall off. And that even as we go into the week and come back on Sunday, that we would worship you from the bottom of our hearts because of your greatness and your power. I wonder if there's anybody today who said, Rulof, I'm backslidden. I don't know Jesus, Lord and Savior. And today I want to make right with God. Because in his greatness and his awesomeness, it is time for me to bow my knee before him and serve him. Anybody today, just stand where you are and say, that's what I want to do, Rulof. Pray for me. Anybody today? All right. If you do want some prayer, there's a team that will go into the prayer lounge. They will pray with you. Remember, if you would like to serve your church and serve the Lord, there is ushers and there's generational ministry. Go and sign up and use the ministry that God has called you to. And we would appreciate that as a church as well. And read the notices. Don't forget what we're doing as a church. Anything, Calvin? If you are here for the first time, thanks. How many of you are here for the first time today? First time at the barn? Just show me by the raising of your hand. Anybody here? Well done. Thank you so much. Anybody else? Okay. Just scan this, and then there's a coffee table just for you. Outside there, you will see it under the umbrellas there. We would love to meet with you as well. God bless you. Have an awesome week. Don't forget these black bags. Help us to collect some food, please. Thank you. Every day, your love never fails.
fails, you make all things work together for my good. You make all things work together for my good. You make all things work together for my good. You make all things work together for my good. Lift your hands and sing it. You make